Father God, that the word will become a living river in each and every person's life, Father God. I pray this morning, Lord God, that your angels will just minister to each and every one, that the Holy Spirit will minister to each and every one, and the word that's being shared this morning, Father God, I pray that the Holy Spirit will speak through my mouth, Father God, and that once again that the word will become living, a living river, living water, that the word will become life in each and every person's life. Father God, we also just stretch our hands out to the prayer wall there at the back, Father God, each and every prayer on those cards, Father God. I pray this morning by the blood and by the name of Jesus that each and every prayer will be answered, Father God, that the angels will go forth, Father God. You say in your word, you will command your angels to go forth and to do what needs to be done, Father God. So I pray that each and every prayer will be answered if it falls in your will. We pray it this morning by the blood and by the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. So once again, welcome to Day Grasha Ministries. This morning, it's my honor just to welcome Pastor Isi Viljoen. She's visiting from Hermanus. Welcome to our little abode. Amen. Just hope you'll be blessed by the message this morning. So this morning we'll quickly do our tithes and offering. If you've got your notebooks or your Bible, open up to Leviticus 27 verse 30 to 32. And here we see the Lord says, "An all offering of the land, whether of the seed of the land or the fruit of the trees, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord." And we see in verse 32, "And concerning the offering of the herd or the flock, or whatever passes under the rod, the tenth one shall be holy to the Lord." So we see clearly that the offering is the Lord's and he calls it holy. Now family, you know me. I'm not here to force the word down in your throat. We're all grown-ups. You know what you're supposed to do. If you want to be blessed financially, as I say almost every week, for the spiritual to take place, there need to be a physical movement. Go back to the ministry of Jesus Christ. Everyone that was sick came to him. Or if he ministered to someone, when he prayed for the blind man, he said to him, "Get up and go wash your eyes." For the miracle to take place, there had to be a physical action. If you want financial breakthroughs, do what the Lord says. Give your tithe to God. And it's not to go into churches' coffers to make the pastor rich. Believe me. It is for God to see that you are serious and that your action is there for the miracle to take place. Amen. If you're in agreement, amen. Amen. So the tenth is holy by definition, and it means it's dedicated or consecrated to God as a holy gift. And now, my favorite scripture regarding finances is Malachi 3:10. But not just Malachi 3:10, verse 11 as well. So God says, "Try me." He tells you, "Try me. Give your tithe and see what I will do for you. I'll open up the heavens for you, and you will not have enough room to store the blessings he'll give you. But if you carry on," he says, "I will rebuke the devourer." Who's the devourer? John 10:10, "The enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy." So he will fight your battles on your behalf if you trust him. And I know that's something very difficult for South African people, especially to trust God with your finances. Because I know South African men are very proud. I'm in control. You know what? Here's a golden nugget. Don't be in control anymore. Let God be in control. Amen. So let's do our confession today. Where's my tithe and offering? So, take your tithe and offerings, hold it up, and let's do our confession. Lord. Now I can't hear you. Lord. In your word, you call the offerings holy. And say that it's yours. I bring my offering to you today as an act of worship to you. And I believe that you will pour out a blessing on my life. And I believe there will not be room enough to receive it. And I stand on your word. Amen. While she's taking up the offering, there's another music clip. Enjoy.
I've been staring at the coastline, thinking of every choice I've made to leave me here right now. Standing on solid ground. And I've been hiding in the shadows, wondering if I'm on the right road, someplace I've never been. Is this how it all? Cause I got my best suit on and I'm ready. I got my sleeves rolled up and I'll be on my way. While my heart's thumping, boom, you're gonna see me ride.
Bye.
Amen. Father God, we just thank you for the finances, for the tithe and offering that came in, Lord God. I pray this morning by the blood and by the name of Jesus that you will direct it into the avenues where it's needed the most, Father God. I also just pray this morning, each and every person that could give or couldn't give, Lord God, I pray that you will give each and every person a chance and open up the heavens upon them, that each and every person here will be able to become a kingdom financer in your ministry. I pray it this morning by the blood and by the name of Jesus. Amen and amen and amen. So family, this week I'm on leave. I went on leave last week Monday, so I'm on 2 week leave. So I thought I'm gonna take it, it's gonna be a relaxed morning. We're gonna have a nice video clip because I'm on leave. I can be on leave, and luckily this morning, last night, the little bird chirped that there's going to be a visitor, so I had to prepare. So this morning, 6 o'clock, when you were still lying next to your hubby or your wife, like it curled up, I was here, opus 5 in the office, started a message for this morning. And you know what, it's just funny how God worked, because as I was preparing the message and as I was going through the message again, I think this is going to speak to a lot of people, but it's also speaking to myself once again, because you know what, the enemy keeps on attacking and he keeps on attacking and he keeps on attacking. And he's stealing your focus just a little bit. And I love using that story with Peter when he walked on the water. When his focus was on Jesus, he could walk on water. But when his focus just turned a few degrees to the storm and the wind, he started sinking. And that's exactly what the enemy does with us. He is whispering, or it's his voice in our ears. Now, my message this morning is, hear God's voice instead of the worldly voice, instead of the voice of the system, instead of the voice of the enemy. All of us today, we love technology. We're in an age of technology. So your senses and your mind is being brainwashed by all the technology that we've got today. So look at the news, each and every day, the news, how we are brainwashed, war, famine, hatred, disease, and you start thinking this is the normal. The movies we watch, the newest one now out is, it's a Disney movie, Buzz Lightyear, lesbians. On a kiddies movie, it's supposed to be a family movie, PG-12 or PG-8 or whatever. Homosexuality on that, already brainwashing the children that it's okay. It's okay. America, if you go do your research, you'll see in a lot of schools in America, or actually not schools, your kindergarten, in Afrika, ons kleuterskole. The kids are already taught how to do spells, magical spells, because they watch Sabrina, the Teenage Witch, and Charmed, and they listen to that voice. It's okay to do it. It's nice to do it. The music that we listen to. When I was in the world, I listened to heavy metal. Been there, I've done it, and I can tell you there's nothing good in heavy metal. A lot of the hip-hop or the rap music that they sing, if you really break it down and you go listen what these guys are singing, it's about sex, it's about drugs, it's about getting high, it's about shooting down people. We're getting brainwashed into that. It's okay. And then lastly, the company that we keep. If you keep the wrong company, It will be detrimental to your Christianity. The word says, and I've got the scripture here, it's in Revelation 8:4, where it says, but we'll get to that now, where it says, you need to go out in the world, you need to give the gospel. But do not be friends with the world, because they will pull you down to their level. So I'm going to say again, the company that you keep. Yes, you are there. Yes, you are calling. Yes, the Great Commission is go out in the world and make disciples of all men. So each and every person sitting here, you are a pastor, because Jesus said, go out in the world and give them the truth. But be careful who you are friends with. Be careful who you sit and visit over a weekend or braai. Gooi jou parels voor die varke en hulle sal het vertrap. So John 10:27. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. Now what this whole message is also about is, if we look at this, this is one voice. This is the voice of God the Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. They all speak in one voice. And this voice wants to speak to you or to me, if you're willing to listen. Every question in life, every situation you've got in life, any troubles, your marriage is failing, the answer is yeah. You've got problems with your children, the answer is yeah. You've got problems with your finances, the answer is yeah. Are you willing to listen to what the word says? Now, this is also very important. God speaks. He speaks. But are we willing to listen, and are we willing to do what He asks us to do? You see, if we truly follow God and if we truly have a relationship with Him, we will firstly hear His voice when He speaks, and you will listen. There's a difference between hearing and to listen. When you hear, you just hear, but when you listen, you hear and you take in. And then you can start applying it to your life so that you can grow. And mostly when you grow, you will carry the fruits of the Spirit, and the worldly people will come eat the fruit of the tree. They will know you by the fruits that you carry. Let's look at Revelation 8:4. He says not to go into the world, but come out of it. That means walk away from sin. Do not partake in the worldly things. Do not. That's what this first part of the scripture means. Do not partake of the drunkards, the sexual immoral people, the thieves, the killers. Do not be like them. Come out of it. It says here, but come out of it. We should not deliberately make close association with the people of the world. What's the company that you keep? Who's your friends? Yes, at work, you might have a Buddhist or whoever. You can be civil, but you're not going to visit every weekend and have a barbecue. South Africans, we have a braai. Americans, you have a barbecue. At work, yes, minister to him. Give him the truth. Let him hear the voice. Because the word says, give them the truth and the truth will set them free. It is all right to do, listen to this, this is the last part of the scripture. So it's Revelation 18 verse 4. It is all right to do business with them and to work with them, but avoid becoming harnessed together with them. Amen. So when you hear God's voice, what do you do? Do you just listen, or do you go into action? Do you do what the word says? Do you listen to the word? Do you apply it to your life? Do you hear the voice of God? Now, if you don't, the only way you're going to hear the voice of God is if you spend time in your word and you spend time on your knees. And in most South African men, if you stop with your stubbornness and you say, Holy Spirit, speak to me. But now you must realize the Holy Spirit can speak through this. It can speak through someone else. And men, he can speak through your wife. And vice versa. Wives, for you as well, the Holy Spirit can speak through your husband. Because when you've got a relationship with your wife and your husband, you can trust each other. So you know the input that you've got. My husband is a godly man. Scripture I also love, and men hate me on this. Wives, submit to your husband. Here comes the second part. As your husband submits to God. So now you've got a godly husband. You know his principles is set in God. So you can take advice. You can listen to his voice. You've got a praying wife that's always on her knees. She's rooted in the word. You know you can listen to her voice. Because it will be a voice of reason. But here's the nugget. If you don't know this, you won't know what voice to speak with. So there's 8 points that I just quickly took out of the Bible this morning where God is speaking, where we need to listen. This whole thing, he's speaking to us. You can open this book any place and he's going to speak to you. Are you willing to listen? Number one, Matthew 6, verse 32 to 34. We usually just deal with verse 33. Who knows Matthew 6, 33? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. But listen to the verse before and after. For the pagans run after all these things. What things are this? What's the word? What's God speaking about? Blessings? Financially? Health? Just being seen in the community? Just to be known in the community? I'm here. Just to have your place? To have a blessed marriage, children, everything here. So, for the pagans run after all these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them. So God wants you. So anyone that tells me God says, the word says you must be poor, doesn't know what they're talking about. Because here, God knows what you need. He wants you to be blessed. He wants you to be successful. He wants you to have a successful marriage. He wants your children to be successful. God wants you to be blessed so you can be a blessing to other people. How can you be a blessing to other people if you are dirt poor? And that goes spiritually, financially. If you are sick as a dog, how can you pray for someone for healing? But you are sick as a dog yourself. But seek, verse 33, but seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Listen to this voice. Listen to the voice speaking. Seek first me and my kingdom and my righteousness. Put me in your life, number one. And all these things that the heathens, that the pagans are running after, that God knows that you need, seek Him first and He will give it to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. Verse 34. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Put your trust in God. Let God be the planner of your life. Jeremiah 29:11, for I've got a dream and a plan for you, and it's a plan to prosper. It's a dream to prosper. It's a dream. We dream this big. God dreams this big. We are always underselling ourselves with what we want in life. You know what? What God wants for you is 20 times better. So just give up and say, God, your will in my life. See God first. Seek Him when you wake up in the morning. Seek Him when you go to work. When you come home again, seek Him. Seek Him in your marriage, in your home. And everything that you want and need, and it falls in the will of God, will be given to you. Number two, Matthew 28:19. If you're writing the scriptures down, Matthew 28:19. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Here God tells us, and people listen to the voice. God is telling you, go out in the world, give the people the truth, minister to people. You do not need to be a Bible puncher. You do not need to walk like this. Now I'm going to minister to people. I've got my... You don't even need your Bible, your lifestyle. What we do on a Wednesday evening, when we go out and we feed the poor, people that don't have, because that's what Jesus did. Do you know, just off the beaten track, do you know the head priest that started the Satanistic church in South Africa is not in Satanism anymore? He gave his life to God. Why? Because of love. Because a Christian woman hugged him, knowingly that he is a Satanist, just hugged him and said to him, God loves you. The love of Christ. God is telling us to go and make disciples. Go and bring people to the kingdom. God is telling us, try and try and try again till the reward comes. Everyone that you see, share the gospel with them and give them the word or the truth. Give them life, which is Jesus Christ. The first night we went out with a feeding scheme. This poor lady, we were giving out the soup and the bread and we were praying for the people, and she just turned around and she said, I had bronchitis, so my voice sounded a bit worse than now. So she said to me, you sound like a morphy. You are a homosexual. Do you know God despises you? And I could see where this was going. I could see this is now the enemy throwing out that hook and hoping that I'm biting. And I just said to the lady, you know what? I'm not going to get into this. I'm not going to fight. I said to her, but what I'm going to do is next week we're going to be back and you'll get the first cup of coffee. 3 weeks later, she apologized. And she called me, not that the title means anything, but she called me, "Pastor, I'm so sorry. I just want to apologize." So if on that first day, if I retaliated, it would have been a lost cause. Yes, we are all human. Yes, we are all human. And the word says we will stumble because we are not Jesus Christ. But what do you do when you stumble? And please don't misunderstand me. This is not an open card to sin. But you will stumble. It's biblical. It's in the Bible. The word says you will stumble daily. What do you do after that? Do you go on your knees and say, "God, you know what? I made a mess. Forgive me and help me so that I don't do it again." Listen to the voice of God. Point number three, and I love this one. Hebrews 10:25, because a lot of people will, they've always got excuses. Listen to the voice. Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as in the manner of some. That means be in church on a Sunday morning. Do not plan your great auntie that's 205 years old, that's on her last leg, now it's her birthday party. Listen to what God says. Do not forsake the gathering of the saints. You can go see her after the service. And family, and I know I'm hammering on this one because this is so important. Why do we gather here on a Sunday? And we'll get to that because I've got scriptures for that. So that we, as a collective, can pray for each other. That can be a supporting system for one another. Because now Yaku, he had a bad week. The enemy is clapping him left, right, and center, left, right, and center. Now he comes to church, he says, "Yes, I had a rough week." Now all the men said, "Right, true, let's pray for you." Yes, but if you're battling phone, man, we'll stand with you. We'll pray. That is why we are here, that you can be accountable to one another. You cannot, you know what? Internet is a very lovely thing. TV on church on TV, it's fantastic. I also listen to a lot of teachings online. But don't let that be your main avenue of getting the word. Because I cannot be accountable to Tiff Shuttlesworth or to Joyce Myers because they don't have a relationship with me. They don't know me from a bar of soap. So they don't know when I step off the path a bit. I cannot be accountable to them. So God is saying this, so we need to spend time together so that we can hear the word, grow from the word, also that we can be accountable to one another. You see, Satan knows the time is running out and he's going to attack from all sides. And if you don't have a support structure, you are going to crumble under his attack. And he's not going to give up because he knows time is running out. Number four, John 13, verse 34 to 35. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. And that example, that Christian lady with the high priest of the Satanist church, love. Love one another. Spend time with one another. Live Christ's love. Now here's the question. What are you willing to offer up for love? Because I know what Jesus offered. I know what God offered up. Just remember what Jesus did for love for you and for me. Point number 5, James 5:16. Now this is why it's so important to gather. Because listen to this. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now, don't misunderstand the beginning of the scripture. You do not confess your sins to Vincent and now you're forgiven. No, 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 no. Only Jesus can forgive your sin. Okay. No one comes to the Father but by my name. Everything goes through Jesus, through the cross, through his blood. Okay. But you are accountable. Yes, Vince, I'm battling. So the next time I'm going to feel like a drink, I'm going to phone him and he's going to support me and say, no man, come over for a cup of coffee. Because when your sin is in the dark, the enemy can use it against you. When it's in the light, God has already forgiven you. The enemy can't use it again. Everyone here knows my past and I had a very dark past. It's out there. No one can use it against me. En ek was met lelike dinge besig. It's my past. But the enemy can't use it against me. Here's the second part to point number 5. Galatians 6:2. Listen to this. Bear one another's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. In other words, support each other, stand together, be a friend to your brother sitting next to you, be a supporting structure to your brother sitting next to you. Be a prayer partner to the person sitting next to you. And in doing so, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Amen. Aren't you glad we didn't do a video this morning? So have relationship. Gather on a Sunday so that we can support one another, so that we can pray for one another, so that we can bless one another. And most importantly, that we can have a rusk after the service. Amen. You're all waiting for that. Point number 6. Matthew 9:37-38. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful. Listen to the voice. And if you don't believe me, it's in red. It's Jesus speaking. Listen to the voice. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Who's the laborers? Us. Go, and I'll say it again, go and get the harvest. Share the word, pray for people, deliver people, give people the truth, help them with their salvation. Share your testimony. That is always a gate opener, share your testimony. This is what God did for me. What it comes down to is do the work. Be a laborer. Because once you do the work, and guess what? You are in the marketplace. You are with the people every day. You see the unsaved. Give them the word. Give them the truth. because the truth will set them free. Point number seven, we've just got two left. Point number seven. And listen to this voice. Matthew 24, verse 36 to 45. But for that day and hour, no one knows. Not even angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Family, I'm warning you, I'm standing here. You know I'm not a pastor, I'm not a person that gives a feel-good message that tells you how everything's going to be okay. Get your life in order, get yourself sorted out. Time is running. People that's thinking we're still going to be here for 50 years, you are truly mistaken. Because listen to verse 37. But as the day of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. And people were laughing at him. If my maths is okay, I think he was building an ark. He was building 500 years. Because he lived till the age of, I think, 900 or 800. People were laughing at him for 500 years. You crazy old man. What are you doing? As I am standing here, and a lot of pastors are standing on the pulpit and saying, the storm is coming, get ready. And you know what? Don't just get ready for the storm. Get your life in order, because you might walk out here and an airplane falls on your head. Doof, just do it. Where did your 5-year plan then go? Sort your life out now. Get your life in order. If your family or friends that you know that, minister to them. Give them the truth. Because then one day you can at least, when you're standing before Jesus, you can say, but I tried. I gave so and so the truth. They didn't accept it. Or do you want to hear Jesus say, why didn't you give so and so the truth? The chance to choose. Verse 39, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. The woman will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house has known that hour, the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. And as I said, people think we've got 20, 30, 40 years left. I'm telling you today, we do not have 30, 40 or 50 years left. A great example that I'll use, go read Revelations. It says, when Israel became a nation, which was the 14th of May 1948, before that generation passes away that witnessed it, Jesus will come back. It's in the Word. So we don't have 50 or 60 years left. Can I exactly tell you when Christ is coming back? No, I can't. But can we figure out more or less what season? Yes. Because he tells you. Go read Prophet Joel, his prophecy. God is going to give us signs in the heavens that time is running out. The birthing pains has already started. Go read Revelations. If you're one of those people that think we've got 100 years left and you want to have a discussion, go read Revelations, the whole book of Revelations. Then you just take a step back, you open a newspaper, you see what's happening, put on your news channel, see what's happening. After you've done that, go read Revelations again, and then you come argue with me. Because then you will be on the same wavelength, and then you will understand time is running out. Listen to the voice. Listen to God saying, my son, my daughter, get yourself in order. I'm coming back. I'm coming back, and I don't want to leave you behind. My son Jesus Christ died for you. Your bus ticket is paid for. Just take it. The last point. John 14:6. And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now, there's some religions out there where you go and you stand in a cubicle and you confess your sins before the priestly father. Where is it biblical? Or you pray and you pray to Saint so-and-so or to Mother Maria or to... Where is it biblical? Here, Jesus says in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. Now, there's a lot of people also that says, oh, you can follow different paths, but all paths lead to God. Yeah, there's a lot of gods. There's like 20 million or 50 million gods that people pray to. But there's one Jesus Christ. There's one man that died on the cross for you and me, and that's Jesus Christ. Not Muhammad, not Buddha, not whoever. Jesus Christ died for you and for me. And if you want to take Christianity as your religion, that is one rule that you've got to follow. Everything goes through Jesus Christ. And family, friends, we're not here to force religion down on you. Jesus Christ gave you free choice. Your choice. So do not say that you are a Christian, but you are a homosexual. No, you're not a Christian. Do not be a Christian, but you steal from your company. You're not a Christian. Do not be a Christian and drink and get drunk, because you're not a Christian. Don't believe me? Go read 1 Corinthians 6:10. Who shall not? 1 Corinthians 6:8-10. Who shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Drunkards, liars, thieves, homosexuals. Now you might say, yeah, but your God of love. Now you're telling me, he's condemning me, he's going to send me to hell. No, Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit sends no one to hell. You choose. You choose. As Jesus himself, and this is, I got this revelation a few months ago. You choose if you want to follow him. But just remember, he chose to hang on the cross for you. Because when he became a man, he had free will. And he said, God, let this cup pass. Let it pass. It's getting heavy now. It's just the feel. But your will. If this is what you want, I'll submit. Jesus Christ, that's a God. I'm submitting and I'm dying. I'm going to die for this people because I love them. So listen to the voice. So listen to, I'm the way, where he says, I'm the way, the truth and life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. So listen to him today. Hear his voice. You see, the whole Bible is about God and Jesus for you and for me. The Bible is not written so God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit can sit there and say, oh, this is what we did in Genesis. We created heaven and earth. No. This is so that you can have life. That you can have a recipe for life. This book is for you and me. Use it. The Bible is the voice of God in print form. And all we need to do is listen. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you for the opportunity that we could share the message today, Father God, and that we can just listen and see some of the voices, some of the messages that the Holy Spirit is giving us, and we're not listening. So I'm praying, Father God, this morning that you will open our ears, Father God, and just these 8 steps, Father God, that we can just start applying this in our lives on a daily basis. And just by doing this, it will have a huge, significant outcome, Father God, that the harvest will come in, that the people out there will receive the truth, that the people out there will be set free, that the people out there will be healed, Father God, that people out there will be delivered, Father God, but most importantly, that the people out there will meet Jesus Christ, who died for them, that the people out there will accept him as their Lord and Savior, and that they will inherit the kingdom of God, that they will receive the promise. If you give your life to me, I promise you that you will sit with me at the table. You will feast with me. 2 weeks ago, the scripture that we shared, Jesus went to heaven and he says there, I'm preparing a place for you in my Father's house. So he's preparing you your room with your king-size bed and your fluffy goose feather duvet and cushions. He's preparing it for you. Jesus, the King of Kings, is the servant. He's telling you, I am preparing a room for you because I love you. I want you there. I want you in heaven. Just choose me. Now, family, while our heads are closed and our eyes are closed and our heads are bowed, if you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, if you do not know him, and if the Holy Spirit is unctioning you, or if you strayed away from your beliefs and from God, a lot of people has got the opinion, once saved, always saved. No, that's not true. Because as you choose to serve Jesus Christ, you can also choose to walk away from him. And a lot of people do. Now people might say, yeah, but if you've got a true relationship with Jesus Christ, you'll never walk away. Yeah, there's merit in that statement. But you know what? A lot of times things happen in life. Things happen and the enemy uses that to break you. That's why I'll come back again to, it's very important not to forsake the gathering of the saints. Because you might have lost a brother or sister now, or a mom or a dad, and you're depressed, and you've got difficulties at work, and the car broke down and the cat bit the dog and the kids are fighting and it's stitches and the TV blew up and the lawnmower, I don't know what happened to the lawnmower. Everything is just happening. Everything is just going wrong. And the enemy knows it. And now he's clapping you. And he's just attacking. And he's attacking. And some point, somewhere, you're going to break. If you don't have a support structure in your life. That is why marriage is so important. That is why a unity with a man and a wife is so important. And that's why the enemy is breaking up marriages left, right, and center. Because he knows a man and a praying man and a praying wife that stands together cannot be broken. Because you're a supporting structure. Now you see your wife is depressed. Now you pray for her. You support her. You speak positivity into her life. And you support her. And tomorrow she sees, okay, you're down. Now she's praying for you and supporting you. And that is exactly why the church is there. So that we can support each other. So the enemy will attack you, and if you stand by yourself, if you're the only tree standing in a hurricane wind, you are 10-to-1 the tree that's going to be uprooted. If that's you, and you've walked away from Christ, I'm inviting you, come back to Him, come back to Him, and you know what, when you give your life to God, and when you're rededicating your life to God again, find a church. And if you're in the Lambton area, take Grasha, it's a good example, but wherever closest to you, where you can call it home, join a church, join the fellowship. And God is saying, and listen to this voice, and this is the most important part of the service, and this is the most important voice that's saying, my son, my daughter, I want you to give your life to me. I, Jesus Christ, I hanged on the cross for you. I gave my life for you so that you may have life. If that's you, I'm going to count to three. And family, don't be embarrassed. No one is looking. And if you're on Facebook and later on YouTube, don't be embarrassed. If your husband or your wife or your children are sitting there next to you, you know what? It's not about them. It's about you. Let them worry about themselves. But as we said in the service as well, for the spiritual to take place, there need to be a physical action. So I'm going to count to three. And if you're sitting at home or here in the church building, just quickly raise your hands up and down. It's for God to see. It's not even for me to see. But it's to show God, you know what, I'm serious. Here I am. Change my life. So 1, 2, 3. And now, so that we don't embarrass anyone, I'm going to ask each and every person here to join in the salvation prayer. Let's start. Lord God, I come to you today by the blood and by the name of Jesus Christ. I confess all my sins, and I ask Jesus Christ to wash my sin away with His blood. You say in your word, whoever calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. I call on the name of Jesus. I accept Him as my Lord and Savior. I accept that He died on the cross. He went to hell. After 3 days, He arose. He ascended into heaven and is sitting at the right hand of God. And as I give my life to Him today, I also invite the Holy Spirit to come into my heart, to change me, to grow me, to teach me, and also to correct me in my life. I prayed, I believe it, and I receive it in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen and amen. And family, as I said, if you are situated in the Lambton, Germiston area, please come join us at Dei Gratia Ministries. We are a close-knit family. We enjoy each other's company after the service. We've got a good flow of coffee and rusks. So please come join us and just be blessed. And let's just close the service with number 6, verse to 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen and amen and amen.